Hello again, this is Pastor St. Thomas. Today we're going to be in Romans chapter 2 and 3, and here we go.
Romans chapter 2. Therefore art thou inexcusable, O man, whosoever thou art that judgest. For wherein thou judgest another, thou condemnest thyself. For thou that judgest doest the same things. But we are sure that the judgment of God is according to truth against them which commit such things. And thinkest thou this, O man, that judgest them which do such things, and doest the same, that thou shalt escape the judgment of God? Or despisest thou the riches of his goodness, and forbearance, and longsuffering, not knowing that the goodness of God leadeth thee to repentance? But after thy hardness and impenitent heart, treasurest up into thyself wrath against the day of wrath and revelation of the righteous judgment of God, who will render to every man according to his deeds. To them who by patient continuance in well-doing seek for glory and honor and immortality, eternal life, but unto them that are contentious and do not obey the truth, but obey unrighteousness, indignation and wrath, tribulation and anguish, upon every soul of man that doeth evil, of the Jew first, and also of the Gentile. But glory, honor, and peace to every man that worketh good, to the Jew first, and also to the Gentile. For there is no respect of persons with God. For as many as have sinned without law shall also perish without law. And as many as have sinned in the law shall be judged by the law. For not the hearers of the law are just before God, but the doers of the law shall be justified. For when the Gentiles, which have not the law, do by nature the things contained in the law, these, having not the law, are a law unto themselves, which show the work of the law written in their hearts, their conscience also bearing witness, and their thoughts the meanwhile accusing or else excusing one another. In the day when God shall judge the secrets of men by Jesus Christ according to my gospel, behold, thou art called a Jew, and restest in the law, and makest thy boast of God, and knowest his will, and approvest the things that are more excellent, being instructed out of the law, and art confident that thou thyself art a guide of the blind, and a light of them which are in darkness, an instructor of the foolish, a teacher of babes, which hast the form of knowledge, and of the truth in the law. Thou therefore which teachest another, teachest thou not thyself? Thou that teachest a man should not steal, dost thou steal? Thou that sayest a man should not commit adultery, dost thou commit adultery? Thou that abhorrest idols, dost thou commit sacrilege? Thou that makest thy boast of the law through breaking the law, dishonorest thou God? For the name of God is blasphemed among the Gentiles through you, as it is written, For circumcision verily profiteth, if thou keep the law. But if thou be a breaker of the law, thy circumcision is made uncircumcision. Therefore if the uncircumcision keep the righteousness of the law, shall not his uncircumcision be counted for circumcision? And shall not uncircumcision, which is by nature, if it fulfill the law, judge thee, who by the letter and circumcision dost transgress the law? For he is not a Jew, which is one outwardly, neither is that circumcision, which is outward in the flesh. But he is a Jew, which is one inwardly, and circumcision is that of the heart in the spirit, and not in the letter, whose praise is not of men, but of God. Chapter 3. What advantage then hath the Jew? Or what profit is there of circumcision? Much every way, chiefly because that unto them were committed the oracles of God. For what if some did not believe? Shall their unbelief make the faith of God without effect? God forbid. Yea, let God be true, but every man a liar, as it is written, that thou mightest be justified in thy sayings, and mightest overcome when thou art judged. But if our unrighteousness commend the righteousness of God, what shall we say? Is God unrighteous who taketh vengeance? I speak as a man. God forbid. For then how shall God judge the world? For if the truth of God hath more abounded through my lie unto his glory, why yet am I also judged as a sinner? And not rather, as we be slanderously reported, and as some affirm that we say, let us do evil, that good may come, whose damnation is just. What then? Are we better than they? No, in no wise. But we have before proved both Jews and Gentiles that they are all under sin. As it is written, there is none righteous, no, not one. There is none that understandeth. There is none that seeketh after God. They are all gone out of the way. They are together become unprofitable. There is none that doeth good, no, not one. Their throat is an open sepulchre. With their tongues they have used deceit. The poison of asps is under their lips, whose mouth is full of cursing and bitterness. Their feet are swift to shed blood. Destruction and misery are in their ways. And the way of peace have they not known. There is no fear of God before their eyes. Now we know that what things soever the law saith, it saith to them who are under the law, that every mouth may be stopped, and all the world may become guilty before God. Therefore by the deeds of the law there shall no flesh be justified in his sight. For by the law is the knowledge of sin. But now the righteousness of God without the law is manifested, being witnessed by the law and the prophets, even the righteousness of God, which is by faith of Jesus Christ, unto all and upon all them that believe. For there is no difference, for all have sinned and come short of the glory of God, being justified freely by his grace through the redemption that is in Christ Jesus, whom God hath sent forth to be a propitiation through faith in his blood, to declare his righteousness for the remission of sins that are past through the forbearance of God. To declare, I say, at this time, his righteousness, that he might be just, and the justifier of him which believeth in Jesus. Where is boasting then? It is excluded. By what law? Of works? Nay, but by the law of faith. Therefore we conclude that a man is justified by faith without the deeds of the law. Is he the God of the Jews only? Is he not also of the Gentiles? Yes, of the Gentiles also. Seeing it is one God, which shall justify the circumcision by faith and uncircumcision through faith, do we then make void the law through faith? God forbid. Yes, we establish the law.
Now, in Romans chapter 2, verses 1 through 16, the Apostle Paul tackles the concept of hypocrisy in the church. People who don't practice what they preach, addressing some of the Christian Jews who are not practicing what they preach. In addressing to the Jews, Paul makes it very clear that in spite of the special relationship God gave to the Jews, in other words, the Jews were God's vehicle or conduit in bringing God's revelation to the human race. That was the special relationship that the Jews had with God. But that did not exclude the sinful nature that all men have, both Jews and Gentiles alike. When you look at the history of ancient Israel, the Israelites essentially rejected God and were in all out rebellion against God, and that's why they were destroyed. But the concept of man's rebellion, it goes back to the Garden of Eden. When you read Genesis chapter 3, the fall of man, I mean, after Adam and Eve ate the forbidden fruit, it did something to our DNA. I mean, just consider this, the first man ever born, Cain, was a murderer. And that says a lot about us, the human race. Like, there's something terribly wrong with our DNA. Now, when you go to Genesis chapter 6, verse 5, we read, it says, the Lord saw human evil was growing more and more throughout the earth, with every inclination of people's thoughts becoming only evil on a continuous basis. I mean, you know, humanity, not only are we hostile towards God, but we're also hostile towards one another. And it's because of this evil that God brought about the great flood on the earth and only spared Noah and his family because Noah was a righteous man. Now, there are over 1,000 flood legends all over the world, and here is a glimpse of the Inca account from an old cartoon video.
It looks like the outline of the Andes Mountains.
Precisely, the identical contours.
Look, it's in the shape of a bird. It could be a landing site, Father. Let's get closer.
Telemachus, do you remember that legend I once told you about the Inca people?
Who are the Incas? The Incas claimed that mysterious beings inhabited the Earth before the appearance of man. They left the planet by airships just before the Great Flood and fled to the far side of the sky.
According to the legend, they used these strange places as landing sites.
Now, Josephus, the Roman historian, tells us that Adam, the first man, made a prophecy and said that the Earth would be destroyed twice. The first time by water, and the second time by fire. And here is a video on Zechariah. In Zechariah chapter 5, verses 1 through 4, the Bible speaks of a flying roll. Now, he's talking about the end time, and he gives dimensions. And these dimensions are the dimensions of a modern-day ICBM. And it goes on to say that this curse will be on the face of the earth, and it will destroy all the thieves, all liars, and those who have lied and cursed in the name of the Lord. It will consume their houses, their stones, and timber. It will consume it all. The same fate will overtake those that fight against Jerusalem in the last days. The Bible says that in Zechariah 14, verse 12, it says that their flesh shall consume away while they stand upon their feet.
Deformed skeletons and vitrified stone at Mohenjo-Daro, Pakistan. Radioactive ash covering the ancient city of Harappa, India, and the biblical cities of Sodom and Gomorrah. According to the ancient astronaut theory, the first atomic blasts may not have occurred during the 1940s, but thousands of years earlier.
What they found in these cities, Mohenjo-Daro, Harappa, Kodigi, others of these Harappan cities, they found people just lying dead in the streets. It was like some doom had just taken over these cities. Some theorists have proposed that what happened to Sodom and Gomorrah, two cities right at the end of the Dead Sea, was some kind of nuclear explosion that wiped this area out. Lot's wife was allegedly turned into a pillar of salt. The idea there would be that when there is a nuclear explosion, people are suddenly vaporized, incinerated, mineralized.
Back to Romans. In Romans chapter 2, verses 14, it says, "For whenever Gentiles who do not possess the law do instinctively what the law requires, they are a law to themselves, even though they do not have the law." Now, God gives the law of conscience to everyone, Jew and Gentile. Like, we all have a conscience. We all know that murder is wrong, stealing is wrong, etc. And to the Jews, Paul said in Romans chapter 2, verse 23, "As you boast about the law, do you dishonor God by breaking the law?" Essentially, God wants us to be obedient to his good moral conduct as is instructed in his word, the Bible. In Romans chapter 3, verses 1 through 20, it speaks about how both Jews and Gentiles are all under sin. And it's echoed in Psalm 143, verse 2. "Do not enter into judgment with your servant, for no living person is righteous in your sight." Now, Job was a righteous man. Job chapter 1, verse 1. There was a man in the land of Uz whose name was Job. He was without sin and upright, fearing God and keeping himself far from evil. Now, look what Job said, because even though he was a righteous man, he could not escape his sinful nature. Like, you know, we all have that desire to do evil, but we must choose to do what is right. But look at what Job said. Job chapter 9, verse 2. "Indeed, I am fully aware that this is so, but how can a person become right with God?" Like, despite his righteousness, you know, he could not escape the sinful nature, at least not before God. Now, back to Romans chapter 2. "Those who disobey the law will be condemned by the law, and that the law is holy, for it comes from God. And anyone who sins apart from the law will also perish apart from the law." In Romans 2, also addresses the law of conscience and the law of Moses. When you break down Romans chapter 2, you get Romans chapter 2, verses 1 through 11, God will judge everyone, good or bad. Romans chapter 2, verses 12 through 16, the law of conscience. And Romans chapter 2, verses 17 through 29, the Mosaic law, the Torah. Now, when you go to Romans chapter 3, verses 1 through 8, the law is holy and from God. Romans chapter 3, verses 9 through 20, Jew and Gentile alike, all have sinned. No one is righteous, not one. The entire human race is under the bondage of sin. Salvation is only found by faith in Jesus, not to be confused with satanic faith. In other words, what Satan has is the knowledge of God. What a Christian, a real Christian, has is the Greek word pistis. It means a conviction of the lordship of Jesus Christ. In other words, you enter into a relationship with God and your conscience of the existence of God. And that's what it means to have faith in the Greek, the biblical saving faith, not to be confused with the satanic faith, because there is a satanic faith out there where you believe in God as in knowledge, but you don't follow God and you don't care about God, just like Satan. Satan knows. I mean, Satan actually saw God, and he's at war with God, and that, you know, his belief in God is not going to save him. So we must have a biblical saving faith in God. Now, God's judgment is based on three standards. One, the truth, Romans chapter 2, verses 2 through 4. It's impartial, Romans chapter 2, verses 5 through 11, and Jesus Christ himself, Romans chapter 2, verses 12 through 16. And salvation is not by works, that nobody can boast or brag about. It's Jesus' sacrifice on the cross that brings the redemption of mankind, Isaiah 53. We obey God out of gratitude because the Holy Spirit dwells in us. Again, grace is not a license to sin. If you live like that, your condemnation is deserved. And the Bible is very clear on that. There is only one mediator, 1 Timothy chapter 2, verse 5. For there is one God and one mediator between God and men, the man Jesus Christ. And there is only one way to God. John chapter 14, verse 6. Jesus told him, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me. We're going to stop right here, but we're going to continue in the book of Romans. Thank you.